17. I'd like to ask everyone to please take a moment and silence all cell phones and electronic devices. For tonight's invocation, we call on Councilmember Jim Butler.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for another day to experience the beauty of your earth, and as we reflect on recent events throughout the world, we are reminded of the magnitude of sin, Father, and your power to defeat and overcome it. We're thankful for our blessings and your love, and Father, please be with this council as we conduct our city's business this evening. Give us guidance in the decisions we make. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. We have a special invitation to council. At this time, council recognizes Mr. Christopher Tate.
Council members, good evening. Thank you for having me back. As we were on our way over to the chambers tonight, we were trying to figure out how long I've been doing this, and we eventually came up with this 2017 marking my seventh appearance before the council. So thank you for welcoming me back to present my annual Amateur Radio Field Day invitation, which of course is what I'm here to do. Amateur Radio has an annual open house event, and it's a preparedness exercise for the radio amateurs, and it's also a contest, but most important, it's a lot of fun. Amateur Radio Field Day is this weekend, Saturday, June 24th, and Sunday, June 25th. The event runs for 24 consecutive hours, beginning at 2 p.m. the 24th and running through the overnight through to the 25th on 2 p.m. on Sunday the 25th. Excuse me. The folks over at the Alamance County EOC have been so gracious in allowing us to hold our event there in their offices for the past 3 years, two or three years, I believe. And we'll be out there again. The Alamance EOC is at 1950 Martin Street here in Burlington, just off North Church Street near the old Western Electric plant. Field Day, as I mentioned, is an emergency preparedness exercise. The major goal is to set up stations using portable power and portable antennas and contact as many other stations as possible within the 24-hour scope of the event. It can get quite intense at times. I've been in that. During the event, we also exchange messages with other radio amateurs as if we were exchanging messages into and out of a simulated disaster zone. Those messages could be for local governments, for FEMA, for example, or even to the media. Those messages could be everything from, you know, needs of shelters to damage assessment to even welfare assistance. It's an opportunity for amateur radio operators to meet the public, so those of you in the public that would like to come and see what amateur radio is all about, you folks are certainly welcome to join us as well. Gives us an opportunity to educate the public on who we are and what we do on a day-to-day basis. Amateur radio operators have been at the forefront of new communications technologies. We were some of the first to connect computers to radios or other similar apparatus, I should say. We had the original text messaging. We were some of the first to engage in satellite communications and even go so far as to bounce signals off the surface of the moon. Because science. Isn't it fun? Anyway, so once again, the Alamance Amateur Radio Club's annual Field Day open house and contest will be this Saturday, June 24th and June 25th from 2 p.m. through the overnight to 2 a.m. at 1950 Martin Street, the Alamance EOC. I look forward to all of you coming to visit. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Tate. And I enjoyed last year visiting, so I hope to join you again this year. Do y'all know how you placed in your competition for points?
Last year, I'll come back.
Last year, the Alamance Amateur Radio Club had three stations, and among other stations in the nation that had three stations at an EOC, we scored 6,480 points, which is kind of arbitrary until we say that in that category, in our category, we place second nationally.
Excellent.
So we're looking forward to hopefully improving on that this year.
Excellent. You've got a very impressive setup.
Thank you.
We have a proclamation this evening in recognition of Parks and Recreation Month, and this time Council recognizes Recreation and Parks staff.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor and members of the Council. It's always a pleasure to be here to celebrate July, which is National Recreation and Parks Month. So it's being celebrated all across our country, our great country, and we're just glad to be part of it. I want to recognize some people. I know you see a lot of us a lot, but some of them you might not see. So I want to recognize some of our very dedicated and hardworking staff. Come on out where you can be seen. This is Jessica Hicks, our athletic director. Next to her is Emily Lott, who was the assistant special events director. Right behind Emily is our talented actor, director, and playwright, Mr. Dave Wright, who manages our Paramount Theater in the downtown Depot area. Behind him in the yellow shirt is Chris Bratcher, who does our amusement park and concessions operations. The man with a lot of hair is Jim Self, who's our park director. And last but certainly not least is Lisa Wolf, our superintendent of recreation. So these people are just part of the staff that makes our recreation and parks program here in Burlington one to be proud of. And we certainly are proud of it. And we're all dedicated to making it the best and it can be and improving all the time. So I want to thank them publicly for all the hard work they do and making our department look good and giving a lot of our local citizens the opportunity to enjoy themselves and have a good quality of life where they don't have to worry about work and other problems they have. They can come out to the parks or all of our activities and programs and get away from it a little bit and have a little fun in their life. You may have a little surprise on your counter there. We got a little sample of some of our things that we do, a visor and water bottle and also a sugar high so that if you get hungry, that's pure sugar in that bag, better known as cotton candy, but we know what it's made of.
No popcorn.
It's my honor on behalf of Council to present this proclamation proclaiming July 2017 as Parks and Recreation Month. Whereas parks and recreation programs are an integral part of communities throughout this country, including the city of Burlington, North Carolina. Whereas our parks and recreation are vitally important to establishing and maintaining the quality of life in our community, ensuring the health of all citizens, and contributing to the economic and environmental well-being of a community and region. And whereas parks and recreation programs build healthy, active communities, aid in the prevention of chronic disease, provide therapeutic recreational services for those who are mentally and physically disabled, and also improve the mental and emotional health of all citizens. And whereas parks and recreation programs increase a community's economic prosperity through increased property values, expansion of local tax base, increased tourism, and attraction and retention of businesses and crime reduction. And whereas the parks and recreation areas are fundamental to the environmental well-being of our community. And whereas parks and natural recreation areas improve water quality, protect groundwater, prevent flooding, improve the quality of the air we breathe, provide vegetative buffers to development, and produce habitat for wildlife. And whereas our parks and natural recreation areas ensure the ecological beauty of our community and provide a place for children and adults to connect with nature and recreate outdoors. And whereas the U.S. House of Representatives has designated July as Parks and Recreation Month, Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Burlington City Council that July is recognized as Parks and Recreation Month in the City of Burlington.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So we have a brief little 3-minute segment that we'd like to show you all. As some of you all may have seen it, I've recently shared some information with Rachel about how we came about developing this 3-minute segment. It's on our website, so sit back and enjoy.
Spaces where families and individuals can get outside and enjoy the fresh air and what goes on.
What we have to offer here within the Burlington community is such a good cross-section of intergenerational activities between all the way from the kids at the parks, the junior seniors, the senior seniors, and the interaction between
with the community getting involved with Burlington Parks and Rec and participating in the things that are being sponsored and giving feedback on things that they would actually like to see. It makes them feel like they are being heard and the things that they really feel good about themselves and things that they really want to see come to the park. We're working to have that come together for them.
The facilities that the city has invested in also bring economic benefit to our community. We're able to host national tournaments, whether it be in soccer or softball or some colleges. We're able to host local tournaments, and all of that brings dollars back into the city's pocket, back into businesses' pockets throughout our community.
You know, when you start off with an idea and a vision for where you want it to go, and when it really happens, when you see people in the community really proud of that, and you hear the word being spread about the great things that are happening, and Burlington Parks and Recs have given us so much support, it just really makes everybody feel great.
And Burlington is a unique place in which government, private citizens, industry, and individuals all come together to have a wonderful place to live, a wonderful place to work, and a wonderful place to be competitive, and also enjoy the outside.
Wow.
Thank you very much for all of that. And now we've got to check off each of those venues on our summer list. We have a second recognition this evening from the NC3C Excellence in Communications Awards. At this time, we recognize Director of Public Policy, Rachel Kelly, and a special guest presenter, Catherine Lazorka.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council and City Leadership. My name is Catherine Lazorko, and I am President of the North Carolina City and County Communicators, also known as NC3C, an organization of more than 120 members representing government communication professionals from towns, cities, and counties all across North Carolina. I'm also the communications manager for the town of Chapel Hill. And with that, I might mention that town manager Roger Stansel sends you his regards. I'm very pleased to join you here tonight to recognize that the City of Burlington won several awards in this year's NC3C Communicators Excellence in Communications Contest. Your city leadership and citizens should be proud that your city swept the contest with four awards in the areas of most creative with least dollars spent for a crime prevention and community engagement campaign, the marketing tools category for two entries, one for promotions at your St. Patrick's Day bash, and the other for your in-house design of the Splash Park at City Park logo, and also in the category of external newsletters for your CityWorks bi-monthly newsletter. This year, we received 133 contest entries from 30 jurisdictions. Just 22 North Carolina governments were recognized. The judges were government communication professionals from around the country, Kansas, Arizona, Texas, Michigan, Maryland, and Oregon. With these awards, NC3C recognizes the City of Burlington and their Public Information Office staff members, Rachel Kelly and Morgan Lassiter, for their excellence in public communication and engagement. Thank you for taking a moment to allow us to recognize the stellar work, energy, and innovation shown by your public information team. NC3C is committed to enriching two-way communication systems that allow governments to interact and engage to enrich people's lives. We believe that government lies at the heart of, we believe that communication lies at the heart of good governance, transparency, and accountability. These awards should convey to your community and the city of that the City of Burlington also upholds these values through its outstanding public information and citizen engagement programs. Thank you and congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you. I just wanted to thank Catherine for making the trip out from Chapel Hill to be with us tonight and recognize the awards the city has won. I really appreciate all the work that Morgan Lassiter does. She couldn't be here tonight, but she was an integral part of this, as well as our part-time staff. They work really hard for us. And thanks to our departments for reaching out to us when they could use some public information assistance and putting up with our crazy ideas.
So. Do you want to point out where the awards are?
Yeah, they're over here on this table. We're going to grab one for a quick photo up, but NC3C is a fantastic organization. They help us do better jobs, get creative ideas, and every year we go and learn a lot from our colleagues, and we're inspired to do better and more creative things for the city. So, thank you.
City Clerk Renee Ward.
Members of Council, it's my responsibility to remind you of your duty to avoid conflicts of interest in matters that are before us. At this time, I ask if there are any potential conflicts concerning tonight's agenda.
No.
I've got one. I'll ask to be recused, and that's the rezoning over on Cortland Terrace, item 3 under public hearings. The conflict of interest is I'm a part owner of a lot about a block away. I'm just asking to be recused out of abundance. Caution, I guess. I don't think it has any impact on me one way or the other. Haven't even looked at the lot in 20 years. I don't even know what's there. But in any event, I would ask to be accused of that.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
or
I'm motion making, recuse? I'll make a motion that we recuse Councilmember Ward.
All those in favor of recusing Councilmember Ward, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Motion is passed. That will be regarding item 3 on our agenda. Before council are the minutes from June 6, 2017 city council meeting. Do I hear a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
Do I hear all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Minutes have been approved. Before council is our agenda, do I hear a motion regarding the adoption of the agenda?
So moved.
Second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? The agenda has been adopted. Next item is our consent agenda. These items are typically non-controversial. If anyone has any questions about them, please let us know. Item A, to approve an agreement for fiscal year 2017 to 2018 between the City of Burlington and Whitsitt Fire Department, Inc. for fire department protection and emergency medical technician services from July 1st, 2017 through June 30th, 2018. Item B, to make the following appointments to the advisory boards and commissions for the 2017-2018 year, the details of which are spelled out in your agenda. Item C, budget amendment 2017-46, final budget amendment, all funds, details of which are spelled out in your agenda. Item D, budget amendment 2017-47, transportation, sidewalks, and intersection improvements, the details of which are spelled out in your agenda. And item E, budget amendment 2017-48, appropriate donations, recreation programs, the details of which are spelled out in your agenda. Do I hear a motion regarding the consent agenda items?
May I make a motion to approve the consent agenda, except item B, we omitted the traffic, so we can omit the traffic commission and public transportation commission. We need to appoint two more people, but approve the public boards and commissions and the consent agenda.
So you're removing the entire, asking to remove the entire list of?
No, just the traffic commission. Not approve the traffic commission and the public transportation commission, but approve all the other commissions.
Okay, so the items listed under each one will continue on.
Yes.
Okay. Any questions from council regarding that motion? Okay. Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor of the motion to approve the boards and commissions minus the traffic commission and the public transportation commission, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Motion is passed.
Okay, what do you need? Are we going to set that to a time?
Yeah, to the next meeting.
Continue that
to the next meeting, those two traffic commissions, the traffic commissions and the public transportation commission.
Okay. Can you motion that?
I make a motion we continue those two commissions until I make a motion that we not approve the all of I made a motion before, but to leave those two commissions out for approval at the next meeting, the next July. What is the next meeting? July 19th?
Yes.
Yeah, July 19th.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
Is that July 18th or 19th? July 18th? All those in favor of moving those to July 18th, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion is passed. We have one item of unfinished business. The public hearing has been continued to consider adoption of the 2017 to 2018 fiscal year budget and community development budget, continued from June 6, 2017 City Council meeting. And this time, Council recognizes City Manager Hardin Watkins.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This will be much shorter than the last time I did this. I just have about 10 slides to get through to give council a quick summary, and those in attendance is a continuation of our public hearing from June 6th. So I'll speak about this very quickly, and Mayor, I'll yield the floor, and you can conduct the public hearing. So let me walk through just a quick budget in brief. General funds about $53 million, not about. It is $53,886,106. It's a 2.88% increase from last year. $500,000 was trimmed from the early proposal the council had seen in May and early June. Three new initiatives, major new initiatives in the budget: LED streetlights, Link Transit, as council remembers, a state grant had expired, which was anticipated, so we'll have a few more expenses related to Link Transit for this next fiscal year. And we have three new direct service positions, staff positions that have been added. 0% increase in sewer rates, 2% increase in water rates, and this is a revaluation year for Alamance County, which drove a great number of our decisions, as you all know. There is an exciting year ahead of us. We're looking forward to lots of new challenges, and lots of those things are included in the budget. Again, you've seen this slide a couple of times before, but again, it just reiterates the point for those in the audience. We are one of the communities you see in the center is the city of Burlington. And my pointer's not really working on the screen. You'll see city of Burlington here is in the red. This is areas that have seen the areas in red are areas that have seen a decline in revaluation. We've declined by 1.62%. As you can see, what's in the yellow or green are all the areas of the county that have increased in value. Those of us in the center here, namely Town Hall, River, City of Burlington, have seen a decline. The other red areas are fire department districts that are built separately as well. So that has been an overriding factor in this year's budget and how we put our numbers together. What staff has proposed is a revenue-neutral tax rate. Let me just remind everybody what that is. That's defined as the property tax rate that will generate the same amount of tax revenue received in the year prior to revaluation, allowing for average growth over the time period since the last revaluation. And so Alamance County's on an 8-year cycle, and so it's our turn to do that. So the revenue neutral rate that staff has proposed is 59.73 cents. That's in your proposal. Let me just restate all that a different way. So in the city of Burlington, in the next fiscal year, it will take 59.73 cents of property tax to generate what 58 cents brought in last year. That's sort of plain and simple what it is. Let me say that one more time. It'll take 59.73 cents to generate what 58 cents brought in. And so that's been the thing that drove our decision on a property tax rate proposal. So our property tax rate projection is a little over $26 million, as you see there. And then you see the graphic that we are revenue neutral in that category. It's a highly unusual occurrence to see the values go down. It is something we're faced with, and that's kind of where we are today. I'm not going to drag a lot of time about this, but the overall county growth rate was 2.6%, which is great for the county. And hopefully when we're doing this 8 years from now, we'll see a positive number as well. Let me run through the rest of the funds. As you see, the general fund, which is what gets most of the attention, $53,886,000. We also have a water resources fund budget. You see the total there, a little over $29 million. We also have a transportation fund. That's obviously where Link Transit's funded. And as everybody knows, we celebrated our 1-year anniversary recently. We have over 80,000 riders. We've talked a little bit about that budget before. We're funding $416,000 for operations out of the general fund. We have some capital expenses that are one-time for sidewalks and shelters. Overall, the proposed budget is $2,023,000. As a reminder to everybody, in the transportation fund, 80% of our funding for capital comes from federal dollars, and 50% of our operations comes from federal dollars. And then I think as everyone knows as well, we have a number of partners around the community that help us with those expenses, and we're greatly appreciative of those. Stormwater Fund has a budget a little over $1.2 million, and that's a $5 per month charge for 22,500 customers. We're not proposing any change in those rates. And then finally, we have a handful of other funds that will require separate adoption. You see those listed here. You've seen those in the other documents. No changes since the last time we were here. So with that, Mayor, I'll wrap it up, and you can open the floor up for public comment.
Any questions from council regarding that presentation? This is a public hearing. At this time, anyone on this side of the room would like to speak? Anyone on this side of the room? Do I hear a motion from council to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Do I hear a second? A second. Thank you. All those in favor of closing the public hearing, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, public hearing has been closed. Do I hear a motion regarding the budget or any questions or discussion from council?
Well, I'm going to say this. I appreciate staff's effort. I think I said that at the last meeting. Staff, Mr. Watkins, Mr. Butler, council. You did a great job on putting a budget together where we were revenue neutral, and I appreciate that. But I made a promise to our citizens that I would not vote for a tax increase, so therefore I'm not going to vote for a tax increase.
Any other? Do I hear a motion from council regarding this budget?
You know, I've spent a lot of time going through the budget and working with city staff on, as well as talking to other council members, and I do believe that a lot of time and effort and energy and certainly
Peggy and Harden every time I called on it. I think they quit answering the call. We were talking about it, but I greatly appreciate it. We had lots of bannering around. You know, it's sobering when your tax base shrinks, and you really have to look at what revenue sources you have out there. And there's been lots of restrictions put on municipal governments in the last few years, and certainly our ability to grow our hampered economic development is our primary source. And Peter, that's on you. You gotta get on that. But obviously, sales tax revenue is a big portion of it. And the House, Representative Steve Ross, has been working hard to give us another vehicle there. And we're much appreciative of that. But staff did a really good job at balancing this budget on the same revenue dollars we had. So while I certainly respect Councilmember Mayor Pro Tem Fawcett's comments, it's an increase in rate alone, but in revenue, it's actually not. So, but I do respect your position on that greatly. But I would make a motion that we adopt the 2017-2018 fiscal year budget ordinance based on the budget that staff's proposed.
I'll second that motion. I respect Mr. Fawcett's position, but a lot of work. We move on, so I'll second the motion.
Do I hear any other comments from council? I would like to note that on the $500,000 budget decrease, there are a number of items related to recreation and parks, including some items on the North Park phase program, which once uncertainty is resolved with the legislature and sales tax, as well as once we have a better handle on sales tax revenues for the 2017-2018 year, I would like to see council revisit in a very timely manner to get that program back on track.
So. Good point.
Any other comments? Motion before council is to approve the budget. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
No.
Motion is passed 4-1. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you again to staff for all of your hard work on this. Next item on our agenda is...
Can I ask, does the community development program need to be adopted as well?
That is correct. Thank you, Councilmember Butler.
It does. I would also make a motion that we adopt the grant project ordinance for the community development program for 2017 and 18.
I'll second that.
All those in favor of approving that, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion has passed. That moves us to public hearings. Item number 2 on our agenda. A public hearing has been set to consider an application to rezone from RO and I restricted office and institutional district to OI office institutional district for property located at 1607 Edgewood Avenue, referenced as Alamance County Tax Identification Number 123965. This time, council recognizes Amy Nelson's surrogate.
I was wondering how that was going to work. Thank you, Mayor, members of council. The request before you tonight is to rezone property located at 1607 Edgewood Avenue from RO&I restricted office and institutional to O&I office and institutional. The homeowners had applied for a building permit to add on to the house, only to find out that the RO&I designation does not allow single-family dwellings as a use, which renders the house non-conforming, which means you cannot expand it, and if the house were to be destroyed, they couldn't build it back. This situation is similar to the one that we had on Rayon Street back in 2015, and in that instance, the house actually did burn down. To give you a little background on this property, when I researched the rezonings in the area, this property is located behind these properties that are on Memorial Drive and Hermitage. Across the street currently is a village at Brookwood, which is directly across the street from Turntime Middle School. The majority of these properties along Memorial and Hermitage were rezoned from O&I to RO&I in 1973. That's 44 years ago, if you're counting. What was puzzling was This area was zoned in March of 1973, and the subject property was rezoned in April of 1973. And at the time of P&Z, I could not figure out why that was. The information is a little sketchy from 1973. But when I researched this property, the village at Brookwood property is the property of the old Memorial Hospital, if you remember that. As it turns out, the Memorial Hospital property and these properties were rezoned on the same night of the City Council meeting in March of 73. There were two separate requests, but they were at the same time. Also on that City Council meeting was a request to rezone the subject property from ONI to R15. These rezonings were staff initiated. There were no applications in the file. The property owner at 1607 contested the rezoning and felt like they should have ONI as well. So they came back the next month and rezoned that property to ONI. These four properties here came in at ONI in 1980. At the Planning and Zoning Commission, staff was asked why we were not recommending R15 for the property since it is contiguous to the R15. But our research showed that this was originally ONI, and we felt that the ONI was more proper to bring it back to where it was. Also, traditionally, office and institutional zoning has been used as a buffer between commercial and residential, and the RONI is really more commercial than it is anything else. So it acts as a buffer, and it also, ONI allows single family use that goes by the nearest residential district, which is the R15, and it also allows office and medical use, which makes it compatible with the RONI. So it's compatible on both sides, and staff felt that the best rezoning for that was the ONI. The Planning and Zoning Commission agreed and gave a unanimous recommendation to rezone it to RONI. And also, as single family use, the property is consistent with the comprehensive land use plan, which calls for traditional residential.
Any questions from council regarding this rezoning request? Thank you very much. This is a public hearing. If anyone on this side of the room would like to speak. Do I hear a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor of closing the public hearing, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, the public hearing has been closed. Do I hear a motion regarding this rezoning?
I move we approve the rezoning.
I'll second.
Any discussion or questions regarding the motion? All those in favor of approving the rezoning, please say aye.
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 All those opposed? The rezoning has been approved.
And I make a motion that we approve the statement of consistency. The statement of consistency, which consists of the City Council finds that the above amendment is consistent with the City of Burlington Comprehensive Land Use Plan, and that this action is reasonable and in the public interest because the amendment is compatible with existing land uses and will provide for the adaptive reuse of the property being rezoned.
Thank you. All those in favor of approving the statement of consistency, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? This moves us to item 3 on our agenda. A public hearing has been set to consider an application to rezone from MFA multifamily district to B1 neighborhood business district for property located at the northwest corner of Cortland Terrace and North Church Street, referenced as Alamance County Tax Identification Number 138307. Before we proceed, Councilmember Butler has been Ward. Sorry. My misspeak. No.
I can leave the room, but I promise you I won't participate in it.
All right.
Thank you, Mayor, members of council. Well, this property located at the intersection of North Church Street and Cortland Terrace currently zoned MFA multifamily. The request is to rezone it to B1 neighborhood residence. The property was rezoned from R9 to MFA back in 1980. There obviously was some intent to do some multifamily development there, but over the years, the ordinance has changed, which has increased setback requirements and landscaping requirements. It doesn't really make this lot conducive to multifamily development. Now, as it is currently zoned, you could still build a single-family dwelling on it because multifamily, single-family use in multifamily districts go by R6 regulations. The zoning, residential zoning around is R9. And the B1 also allows single-family dwellings, but it goes by the nearest residential district, which would be the R, which would be the R9, which makes it more compatible. So the property could be used for either currently multifamily or single-family. And the B1 brings in a commercial component. As you can see by the map, there's commercial around the property. But B1 neighborhood businesses are usually small businesses that are supported by the neighborhood. It gives a walkable ability to, you know, we all grew up, or some of us grew up with the old corner store. And this is what the B1 is about. This is also consistent, if you'll see, with the comprehensive land use plan, which calls for this particular area to be neighborhood and commercial. So it is consistent with the comprehensive land use plan. The Planning and Zoning Commission gave a unanimous recommendation to rezone the property. And obviously, staff recommends the rezoning. If you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer.
Any questions from council? This is a public hearing. If anyone on this side of the room would like to speak. Anyone on this side of the room? Do I hear a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
All those in favor of closing the public hearing, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Public hearing has been closed. Do I hear a motion regarding this rezoning request?
Based on PNZ's recommendation to staff, so I'd make the motion that we approve the rezoning request as written.
Second.
Any questions regarding the motion? All those in favor of this rezoning request, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion has been approved.
Also make a motion that we approve the statement of consistency. Whereas the City Council finds the above amendment is consistent with the City of Burlington's comprehensive land use plan, and that this action is reasonable and in the public interest because the amendment is compatible with existing land uses and will provide for the adaptive reuse of the property being rezoned.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor of the statement of consistency, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Statement has been approved. This moves us to item number 4 under new business. City Council will consider approving a memorandum of understanding between the City of Burlington and Piedmont Authority for Regional Transportation that governs the plug-in electric vehicle charging station roles and responsibilities. This time, Council recognizes Transportation Director Mike Nunn.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Thank you for having me here tonight to speak to you about the electric vehicle station. Before I begin, I looked up some stats talking about public charging in the nation. It's actually doubled since 2015. I don't know, as you've driven around and traveled, maybe you've seen more of these units. I'm going to show you some pictures this evening, but things seem to be increasing in this area. They've gone from about 8,000 to 16,000 in the last 2 years. But this grant program is a partnership between Duke Energy, PARC, which is Piedmont Authority for Regional Transportation, that runs our commuter service through Alamance County right now, and of course the City of Burlington. The grant program, which PARC coordinated, facilitated, applying for our area, provides $10,000 for each charging station. There will be 3 in our area. There will be 1 in Burlington, if you approve this, 1 in Graham, and 1 in Mebane through this program. Now, there are other stations around at car dealerships, hotels, the Tanger outlets, as I'll mention later. So we have a few in the area, but these will be through the Duke program. So we'll have 3 new additional charging stations. The electrical expense with that, I did do some checking around, looking at some average stations. You see there, $25 to $50 a month. Winston-Salem, for example, their downtown high-use facilities is about $47 a month. you could estimate ours will be less than that just by the use of our station. PART will manage the entire install process. Then they will transfer that station to the City of Burlington. That will be City of Burlington property to handle that. We will handle the service line to the EV unit, taking care of that installation. And then going forward, the city will be responsible for any maintenance or electricity costs for that. Downtown areas are preferred, but you also, as I mentioned, you see them out by the highway, you see them in other places. But downtown sort of gives you a twofold benefit from a driver. The tracks in the downtown, there's things to do while their car is charging, and it's also a convenience. So maybe they would decide to come into downtown versus charging out on the highway just by having things around. Sort of a built-in attraction is the way it was explained. Also, you'll be on all the apps and the websites when EV drivers pull up this information. When they travel, they like to know where these sites are. So Burlington now will pop up with this site for our downtown. So it'll be a great opportunity to expand our presence. Staff has evaluated this. The city lot number one, which is just behind the co-op, and I'll show you a picture here shortly of that, for two of the all-day existing spaces that we have that are already there for all-day parking. It is a big electrical outlet. When you ask about maintenance, it is a EV unit, but basically any electrical contractor can repair this unit. It's a big plug, if you will. Very advanced plug, but it's not that detailed. A lot of questions about that, the maintenance and downtime and who fixes it. So we've checked into that. It is a national brand. They're used nationwide. So we've taken care of that question as well. It provides about 10 to 25 miles per hour, depending on your vehicle. So maybe an hour to come downtown and eat a meal, walk around, do a little shopping. You're going to get some charge. You may not completely charge, but you'll be able to stop off and get 10 to 25 miles. And I've mentioned the other stations around as well. There's one at the Outlet Center, and then both will be one downtown Mebane, downtown Graham, and if we approve this, downtown Burlington. Looking specifically, using the pointer, this is the co-op facility. This is lot one. This is the depot station, Amtrak station, and just over here is our Worth Street temporary hub for our transit system. Just to give you a relationship, there's a walkway here across this behind the co-op. We're looking at just to the left of that, two spaces right here. So you're basically in the middle, be seen, visible, safe, and a good location to access both ways, wherever you would go in the downtown area. The little orange spot, if you can see that, we're going to run directly a service from here over to roughly where this pole is at existing here. So there'll be a meter set. The city actually owns this property in this alleyway. We'll be able to set a meter, run the service, patch it up, make it look nice, and the EV unit would sit right here. This is what the unit will look like. It's called ChargePoint. As I mentioned, they're a national, almost an international company that provides these. It'll be a two-unit station. They look much like a gas pump. So you would pull this this piece out here, stick it into your unit. You have an adapter with your vehicle. Two cars can charge at the same time. It's a smart unit, if you will. There will be data provided. We'll be able to know how long people are charging, what time of day, date, and things of that. So we'll be able to get some information from this unit as well. But it's just a pull in, park your car, plug up, go do what you'd like to do. This is some examples. The one on the right, will be more what we're talking about, two parking spaces, the unit in the middle. Of course, our service will be coming off of a building. But here's another example up close of what a unit looks like. It's very slim, sleek. As well as the signage above it, but you know what it is when you pull in there. We're not sure if we'll have the pavement markings, but it will be well marked as far as where to go and where to park. The next steps, of course, tonight, if you choose to accept the Duke grant award of $10,000, we would approve an MOU and the assignment agreement, which is in your packet, with PART, again, so we would accept it after it's installed, after it's operating, and then we would take it forward from there. We'd install the service line and the unit, and then activate that unit probably in July or August. And I can answer any questions if you have it.
Any questions from council?
So that $50 a month, that is what you're estimating would be the city's cost?
That's the high side. I pulled Winston, Greensboro. Folks have had them for like 2 years, much more populated area than ours, and they were at $47 pretty consistently each month. So 25, maybe you could take half of that, but that's the highest they've seen is $47 a month, and that's a downtown.
The national average is $18.
Yeah.
Any other questions or comments? I know I've heard from a number of electric vehicle drivers that are looking forward to this amenity and recognize its attraction to bring people to downtown. Do I hear a motion regarding this memorandum of understanding?
Make a motion that we approve the MOU with Park for the EV station.
Second.
All those in favor of the memorandum of understanding and approving it, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion is passed. Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
We have no public comments signed up for this evening. That moves us to city council comments. Any council comments?
I've got one, as always. The mayor stated that we're making cuts at North Park. Yeah, we're going to make cuts at North Park and some other places as well. North Park is not getting cut out of this budget. I want people, the public, to understand that are concerned about that park. The park is going to continue, and we're going to continue to get the job done over there. So don't worry about the cuts that we've made to that, but it's going to get done. I can assure you that, whether I'm here or not, it's going to get done, finished. I just want to make that clear that we did make cuts, but the park's not going to go away.
Any other council comments? I've got a couple items coming up. July 3rd is our annual 3rd of July in the park. We'll have a number of events going on down there. It's always a fun day. Starting at 1 p.m., the fun starts with rides and attractions. Music's from 5 to 9:30 p.m., and then the fireworks are, as usual, at 9 p.m. So look forward to seeing a good crowd out there. We've also got four Fridays coming up this Friday from 4:30 to 9 p.m. in downtown Burlington. We look forward to a good crowd out there. This is the second in our series of Fourth Fridays for the year. And then we had our Link Transit one-year anniversary the other week. I had a wonderful time riding the system and doing some informal town hall meetings with riders. Had a lot of good feedback. And it's really impressive the way that system is empowering our citizens to get out, get to work, get to an education, get their shopping done, and stay healthy. I think the overwhelming theme from talking to residents is really that Link Transit gives them freedom in the community to be healthy, active, engaged citizens. And they really appreciate all that council's done to make that service available to them. I know there were a number of groups conducting surveys on the system, and look forward to getting those results back in the coming months. And then just wanted to note to council, I'll be traveling the next couple of days on a conference trip to Kansas City. Thankfully, Kauffman Foundation has graciously funded the trip in full, travel expenses board and the conference. So great opportunity to meet with over 400 leaders from around the country talking about entrepreneurial ecosystems and how we support small business development in our cities. Any other council comments?
Council's done, I have one. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna call on Rachel Kelly to come to the podium. She's gonna make a quick one additional announcement.
We just recently found out that a friend in our front row is gonna be departing onto bigger, awesome things. So I just wanted to take a second to thank Natalie for her coverage of the city, diligent reporting on the police, breaking news. I know she's up all hours of the night covering things happening here, distilling really complex and sometimes less than exciting topics that city council covers to make sure that our residents are informed and that what we're doing is transparent. So we just want to thank you and wish you all the best. If you want to say anything, you're welcome.
Thanks, Arden. It's been a pleasure covering the city. I know I've just been filling in when we didn't have a full-time city reporter, but it's been a pleasure, and I appreciate all of you for being gracious and helpful and explaining things when I needed that and providing clarification for the public when I pressed you on issues. So it's been a joy to be here. This is my hometown, so I'm going to Nashville, but I'll be back, and I'll remember this time so sweetly for the rest of my life. It's been a joy to cover my hometown, so yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Do I hear any further business from council?
Can I wait to make one announcement?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, Mayor, members of the council. Sorry, I don't want to take too much of your time, but I do want to mention that the Burlington Royals start their season this week. They're actually playing an exhibition game tonight. We tried to get their general manager to come to a council meeting, but conflicts arose, and especially with tonight's game. But it's an exhibition game against one of the Coastal Plain collegiate teams, so it won't count in their record, so you're not going to miss anything. But their first home game will be Thursday night, and they'll play 35 home games during the regular season. Hopefully they make the playoffs, which they add a few more games, but we're looking forward to the Royals back in town, and it presents a lot of good entertainment for families to come out and enjoy the games, and certainly I encourage all of y'all to take advantage of that too. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other business from council?
I think it's, you know, you need to make a request to go into closed session to pursuant to 143.318.11(a)(6) to discuss a personnel matter.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor of going into closed session, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Council will return shortly.
Hey, Jim, could you see by putting the top on this one?
please.
We're never done.
Do I hear a motion?
Make a motion, go back in open session.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Meeting is adjourned. We'll see everyone.